Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Imtiaz Hassan from Jamia Millia Islamia. Today we are going to talk on paper 10 Biophysics, in which we discuss about the module 27, which contains information about light scattering, elastic and inelastic scattering, Stokes and anti-Stokes scattering and selection rule. In this module, we are going to discuss about the basic concept of scattering, how the light is scattered. Then we will talk about the types of photon scattering, which includes Raman scattering. Then we will discuss about the quantum description of the Raman effect, and then we discuss about some selection rules and rotational and vibrational Raman. We also talk about the light scattering of small and large particles. At the end, we will provide you summary of this lecture. So guys, first we will talk about the light scattering. What is light scattering? When light travels through a medium, it is scattered from individual atoms. When the arrangement of the atom is uniform or regular, such as in the solid and glass, the light is scattered from different atoms and cancel each other, so there is no scattering is observed. However, when light is scattering is a consequence of interaction of light with the electric field of a small particle or the molecule, an incident photon induces an oscillating dipole in the electronic cloud. As the dipole changes, the energy is radiated in all the directions. This radiated energy is called scattered light. The scattering of light may be thought as thought of the redirection of light that takes place when an electromagnetic wave, that is the incident light rays, encounters the obstacle non-homogeneously. In our case, the scattering material, solid, liquid or gas. As the electromagnetic wave interacts with the matter, the electron orbits within the constituent molecule are perturbed periodically with the same frequency as the electric field of the incident wave of the light. Now we discuss about the types of photon scattering. Photon scattering are of different type. The first one is the Thomson scattering, which describes the electromagnetic radiation in a simple classical process scattered by electron of ionized gas when Thomson cross section. In Thomson scattering, the radiation is not absorbed but reappear as radiations traveling in a different directions. There is no change in frequency in quantum terms of photon collides elastically with the electrons. In other words, the photon energy h nu is much less than the rest of the mass of the electron. Now we talk about the another type of scattering, that is known as Compton scattering. The Compton scattering is observed in X-rays passing through a solid or gas. The essential interaction is between higher photon energy and individual electrons. Under conservation of momentum and energy, the Compton scattering is described as the delta lambda dash minus lambda, that's equals to h by m naught c into 1 minus cos phi, where the lambda dash is the wavelength of the scattered photon and lambda is the wavelength of the incident radiation. You can see here in the figure that how the Compton scattering is described and how the energy terms are given. Here we discuss about the Rayleigh scattering. The Rayleigh scattering is described first time by the Lord Rayleigh, and he calculated that the dipole scattered is much lesser than 1, that is the scatter of with an intensity. The Rayleigh scattering is given by in an equation that I equals to I naught 8 pi n alpha square divided by lambda to the power 4 into r square into 1 plus cos square theta, in which the n is the number of scattering radiations, alpha is the polarizability, lambda is the wavelength and r is the distance of the scatter observer. So it is clearly in showing that intensity is directly inversely proportional to the lambda to the power 4. that is 5 times more effective for 400 nanometer than the 600 nanometer. That is the reason that a sky looks like blue, and at the sunset it looks like the red. Elastic and leave the molecule in the same state is called relay scattering. However, the inelastic and leave the molecules in a different quantum state is called Raman scattering, which is given by Dr. C. V. Raman in 1930. Here we talk about the Raman scattering. The Raman scattering results from the interaction of light with the vibrational mode of molecules constituting the scattering medium. Raman scattering can be equivalently described as the scattering of light from optical photons. Raman scattering can occur by change in vibrational, rotational or electronic energy of the molecules. The difference in the energy between the incident photon and the Raman scattered photon is equal to the energy of vibration of the scattering molecule and is described by inelastic scattering. You can see here in the energy diagram that in the case of Rayleigh scattering, both excitation and emission energy is equal, so the amount of energy during scattering is remains same. But in the you can see in the case of Raman scattering, that is the inelastic scattering, are of two types. One is the Stokes scattering, in which the h nu minus h nu m and the difference in some energy left. Similarly, in the case of anti-Stokes scattering, h nu plus h nu m is given as the energy of the scattered light. So, if there is no change in the frequency between the incident and scattered photon, this scattering is called Rayleigh scattering or elastic scattering. However, if there is a change in the energy was observed of the scattered photon, is either of two types, one is the Stokes or the anti-Stokes scattering, which is named as Raman scattering or inelastic scattering. Here we try to describe classically the Raman effect. You can see the mathematically the Raman effect can be described. First, you can see in the image that how the electronic field and the magnetic field of the scattered light when it interacts with the molecules in the Brownian motion. And you can see here that the incident electromagnetic wavelength induces electric dipole oscillating in phase P equals to lambda E naught cos 2 pi V naught T. In general, the polarizability alpha of a molecule depending on the atomic position. Thus, alpha is modulated by molecular vibration to first approxima, and it is described as alpha equals to alpha naught into plus delta A by delta Q into Q naught cos 2 m vibrational T. And the diagram is shown here that x axis from minus q to the plus q and alpha value gives a particular types of the spectrum. We further described the mathematical expression of the Raman spectrum, Raman spectroscopy. So, you can see here the resulting time dependent polarization producing dipole radiation in all directions. It could be Rayleigh scattering or elastic scattering when P equals to alpha naught E naught cos 2 pi V naught T. However, in the case of Stokes or an inelastic scattering, delta alpha by delta Q into E naught by 2 into cos 2 pi V naught minus V vibrational T. And if the plus cos 2 pi V naught plus vibrational T is added, it is the case of anti-Stokes inelastic scattering. So, in general, the Raman selection rule delta A by delta Q should not be equal to 0. Here we talk about the quantum description of the Raman effect. You can see here the system of atoms, molecules, light and their interaction is described by H total equals to H E plus H R plus H L plus H I, and H I equals to H E R plus H E L. Quantum theory of non-resonant Stokes Raman scattering is given as a long equation, and finally the third order of TD perturbation theory, given the sum of AB and QKs, and describes the Raman tensor. Here we try to describe the all three types of scattering in the detail. The first is the Rayleigh scattering. You can see here the two energy levels up and down are almost same, and it is a parametric process in which a spontaneous scattering process are incoherent and anisotropically distributed in all directions. We talk about the Stokes and anti-Stokes scattering. You can see here these are the spontaneous Raman scattering, and energy is stored in or extracted from the molecule or crystal. I Raman R is equal to 10 to the power minus 3 to 10 to the power minus 7, and a scattering cross section is greatly enhanced by electronic resonance. The ratio of intensity determined by Boltzmann factor phi prime alpha by phi prime s equals to omega into ohm k divided by omega minus ohm k to the power 4 exponentially minus h omega k kbt. So I Raman's AS is equals to almost equal to 10 to power minus 1 to 10 to power minus 2 Rams. Here we discuss about the Stokes lines and anti-Stokes lines in detail. In general, the scattered light contains frequencies different from those of the excitation source. Those components shifted to lower frequency, and that's called Stokes line. You can see here in the structure. However, in the anti-Stokes line, those shifted to a higher frequency are called anti-Stokes lines. The Stokes lines are typically order of magnitude more intense than anti-Stokes line, because at thermal equilibrium and normal temperature, the population of electrons in level n state is smaller than the population in ground state, resulted from the Boltzmann energy distribution n that is proportional to e to the power minus h nu by kT. We try to see here the Raman spectrum of sulfur. So first we should understand the Stokes scattering results when molecule are in their ground state. When it interact with the beam of light, some of the energy from the colliding photon is enhanced into the vibrational mode of the molecule. This causes the light to be absorbed and then re-emitted. You can see here the ground state, first excited state, and virtual energy level, and how the change in the energy level occurs because of the Stokes scattering. Now you can see the Raman spectra of the sulfur, in which the Raman Stokes are generated at 472 wave number, 218 wave number, and 153. The three peaks are observed for the Raman Stokes. However, the Rayleigh scattering is suppressed by notch filter, and there should be no peak ideally, but you can see here that Raman anti-Stokes lines are appeared at minus 153, minus 218, and minus 418 wave number. You can see here the anti-Stokes scattering. Anti-Stokes scattering occur when the molecules is in a vibrationally excited state. When it interact with the radiations, the interactions can cause to drop to ground state and lose some of it in vibrational energy to the re-emitted a higher frequency of the light. You can see here the energy diagram of the anti-Stokes scattering, in which the ground state, first excited vibration state, and the virtual energy level show a remarkable difference in the energy levels between the ground state and the first excited state. Here we describe the Raman effect as a coherent effect. You can see here that the stimulated Raman scattering, simple Raman spectrum allows the amplification of a Stokes component into Raman laser, and anti-Stokes experiences negative gain in two photon picture. You can see here that the Stokes and anti-Stokes coupling by four wave mixing, and comparable intensities of Stokes and anti-Stokes controlled by a phase matching. Now we talk about the selection rule. Roughly speaking, the primary selection rule for a Raman transition is that the molecular polarizability must change during the molecular vibration. The polarizability of molecule tells us about how hard or how easy it is for an electric field to change or distort the electron cloud in an atom or the molecule. An atom in which the electron cloud is further away from the nucleus has a larger polarizability than an atom where the electron cloud is closer to the nucleus. There are several useful generalities we can make concerning Raman and IR spectroscopy. A systematic vibration leads to the relatively strong Raman signal and no IR signal. In case of symmetric vibration, in case of asymmetric vibration, lead to the much weaker Raman signal and are often quite strong in IR spectroscopy. Bending vibration modes lead to much weaker Raman signals and are often quite strong in IR spectroscopy. A molecule can have both IR and Raman signal at the same frequency, though if the Raman signal is strong, the corresponding IR peak will be weak and vice versa. The Raman scattering selection rules can be as follows. The scattering is not an oscillating dipole moment. The presence of an electric field E induces polarization in an atom molecule given by in atoms. The polarizability is isotropic and the atom acts like the antenna and re-radiates at the incident frequency. Rayleigh scattering only in molecules, the polarizability may be anisotropic and depend on the rotational and vibrational coordinates. This can also give rise to Raman scattering. There are some gross selection rules. To be Raman active, a molecule must have an isotropic polarizability. Less restrictive than the need of for a dipole moment, symmetric molecule can be Raman active. Now we talk about the rotational Raman. Linear molecules, the polarizability tensor is an isotropic in which the alpha perpendicular should not be equal to alpha parallel. A molecule rotates, the polarizability presented in the electric field changes. The induced dipole is modulated by radiation rotation and results in the rotational transitions. You can see here the frequencies of the different lines. That you can see the Stokes line is found at the J plus 2. In the Rayleigh scattering, it is at the J, and anti-Stokes scattering at the J minus 2. Even non-polar molecules such as oxygen, nitrogen, carbon dioxide exhibit rotational Raman spectra. So the specific selection rule that's effective to photon process and are given as delta J equals to 0 plus minus 2, which is 0 is the Rayleigh scattering, plus minus plus is for the Stokes line and minus is for the anti-Stokes line. Here we discuss about the rotational Raman spectra. In the case of rotational Raman spectra, you can see the energy diagram and Rayleigh scattering found at the 0 position. However, the left side, the Stokes lines, and the right side, the anti-Stokes lines are appearing. It is mathematically given as by the assuming a rigid rotor Fj equals to Bj into J plus 1. Stokes lines are observed at frequency equals to V naught minus Fj plus 2 minus Fj equals to V naught minus B 4j plus 6, and anti-Stokes lines appear given as frequency equals to V naught plus Fj minus Fj minus 2 equals to V naught plus B 4j minus 2. So the first anti-Stokes line is J plus J equals to 2. That is the gap of 6B between V naught and the first line of each branch, and lines in each branch is equal spacing equals to 4b. Now we can see some example of some rotational Raman spectra. You can see here the 3:1 intensity alteration observed due to nuclear spin statistics. 3 times as many ortho H2 level odd J as the para H2 even J. A spectrum allowed because all transition connects level at the same symmetry. Likewise, nitrogen 14 Raman spectrum shows 2:1 alteration. You can see here the Stokes and anti-Stokes line of the hydrogen. For the same reason, alteration lies are the completely missing in the Raman spectra of oxygen 16 and carbon and oxygen 16. If the level does not exist, one cannot see the transition to and for it. We try to show here the some vibrational Ramans. The gross selection rule, the polarizability must change during the vibration delta d alpha by dq is not equal to 0. In practice, this means the normal mode must transform with the same symmetry as the quadratic forms x square or xy, etc. For a diatomic molecule, even homonuclear diatomics satisfy the gross selection rule. It exhibits Raman spectra. You can see here for the water, it is a Raman active and its frequency. The first frequency at 3652 per centimeter, second frequency at 1595 per centimeter, and third frequency at 3756 per centimeter. A specific selection rule dV equals to plus minus 1 stock plus for the Stokes and minus for the anti-Stokes. And anti-Stokes rarely observed when V is very more than 0 and weakly populated. For polyatomics, need to check each normal mode against the selection rule. We discuss here about the rule of mutual exclusion. In the case of carbon dioxide, it is not coincidence that those modes which are Raman active are IR inactive and vice versa. This is an example of the rule of mutual exclusion, which states in a centrosymmetric molecule, that is one with a center for inversion symmetry, a vibrational mode may be either IR active or Raman active, but not both. You can see here with the diagram clearly. You can see here the light scattering of small and large particles. A small particle, one scattering center, and intensity is independent of scattering angle, that is the Rayleigh scattering. You can see here if the phase of the scattered light are the same, then cancel each other, and therefore there is no scattering are observed. It's known as Rayleigh scattering. For a large particle, multiple scattering occurs at the center, and scattering is depend on the angle and gives the diffraction like pattern. Now we talk about the static light scattering. In the case of static light scattering, the particle size information is obtained from intensity of the scattering pattern at various angles, and the intensity is depending on the wavelength of the light, scattering angle, particle size, relative index of refraction n of the particle, and the medium. It is a simple diagram showing that the laser is the light source from which the light comes and directly interact to the cuvette in which the sample are taken. So once the scattering occurs at right angle, the photon counting device are attached, which is converted into the digital signal, and this way we should be able to determine the particle size by using a static light scattering. Let's talk about the dynamic light scattering. Dynamic light scattering technique is used to measure the size of particle, typically in submicron region, also refers as photon correlation spectroscopy or quasi electron light scattering, in which particle are suspended within the liquid medium which is undergoing Brownian motion, and larger the particle, slower the Brownian motion will be. So, DLS monitors actually the Brownian motion with light scattering and measuring the zeta potential of particle and measuring or estimating the molecular weight of the substance based on the scattering observed because of the Brownian motion. The speed at which the particles are diffusing due to Brownian motion is measured by recording the rate at which the intensity of a scattered light fluctuates. DLS and Brownian motion. So, a suspended particle is constantly and randomly bombarded from all sides by the molecules of the liquid, and this makes the particle jump. This small random jumps are making the Brownian motion actually. The technique DLS measures the speed of particles undergoing Brownian motion. The speed of Brownian motion is influenced by actually the particle size or sample viscosity or temperature. And so therefore, the viscosity is the important factors for determining the speed of Brownian motion. Of course, temperature must be accurately known and automatically read back by the software. So, it needs to be stable during the measurements. So, if you keep the viscosity and temperature constant, then we can be able to measure the particle size by measuring the scattering process. The convention current is in the sample causes non-random movement, which prevent the accurate size interpretation. Now we talks how the DLS actually works. The particle size is given in terms of hydrodynamic radius, and the hydrodynamic radius is the diameter of a sphere that has same translational diffusion coefficient as the particle have. So hydrodynamic size, by definition, it is given as the diameter dh, the diameter of the hard sphere that diffuses at the same speed as the particle of molecule being measured. Hydrodynamic radii will depend not only on the size of the particle core, but also on any surface structure as well as the types and concentration of any ions in the medium. So, the particle size or the hydrodynamic radii is actually measured by DLS using a Stokes Einstein equation, which is given as dh equals to kT divided by 3 pi eta d, in which k is the Boltzmann constant, T is the absolute temperature, eta is the viscosity of the medium, and d is the translational diffusion coefficient or velocity of the Brownian motion. So, if we know these parameters, we can measure these parameters, by that way we can be able to measure the hydrodynamic radii of the particle in solution by using dynamic light scattering. Try to show you the instrumentation. You can see here in the dynamic light scattering, it has a laser source followed by monochromator, which selects the light of particular intensity and which directly falls to the sample, which is kept in the cuvette. Once the laser light falls to the sample, the scattering process occurs, and the scattering can be measured at the different angle. Multi-angle collector are also there, which directly collect the scattered light and detected comes to the detector followed by the correlator, and based on that we will be able to determine the size of the particle or the hydrodynamic radii of the particle. Correlation function. In the DLS, the correlation function is a very important parameter. Correlator actually monitors the light intensity fluctuation and compares the intensity of signal at time t0 to the intensity at a very small time later t plus delta t. So, for a monodispersed particle cumulant analysis, g tau equals to a into a plus b exponential 2 tau t, and tau equals to dq square and q equals to 4 pi eta by lambda naught sin theta by 2, in which d is the translational diffusion coefficient. The velocity of the Brownian motion is defined by the property known as the translational diffusion coefficient, and n is the refractive index of the dispersion. For the polydispersant particle, a non-negative least square NNL or contin are used, and it is given as g tau equals to a into 1 plus bg1 tau square. You can see here in the diagram that for a bigger particle in which the correlation of the signal takes longer time to the decay, while in the case of a small particle it moves more rapidly, so the correlation decreases as quickly as. Here we talks about the zeta potential, that's it measures the charge of the particle also. A potential exists between the particle surface and dispersing the liquid, which varies according to the distance from the particle surface. To determine whether the particle within a liquid will tend to flocculate or not, the measurement of the laser Doppler velocitometry and phase analysis light scattering are used for the measurement of the zeta potential. You can see here in the diagram that how the zeta potential of a charged particle can be measured by using dynamic light scattering. So guys, let us summarize what we have learned so far. The light scattering is a valuable information to channel chemical structure, dynamical process and interaction. In Raman scattering, the scattered photon has different energy that's depend on the frequency and wavelength than the incident photon. Stokes lines are those in which the photon has lost energy to the molecules. Anti-Stokes lines are those in which photon has gained energy from the molecule. To be a Raman active molecule, it must have an isotropic polarizability less restrictive than the need for a dipole moment. Symmetric molecules can be a Raman active. A suspended particle is constantly and randomly bombarded from all sides by the molecule of the liquid. This makes the particle to jump, and these small random jumps are called Brownian motion. Measuring the size of particle, typically in the submicron region, also referred as photon correlation spectroscopy or quasi light scattering. So this method is used to estimate the particle size that is based on the light scattering. I hope you have understand very well the light scattering process. Thank you very much.